Is now the deadliest force for destruction.
There's only one way to stop her, and that is to kill her.
Who will survive in the outer world of inner terror? A galaxy where friends become your enemies, nightmares become your life, and life becomes your death. A new generation of adventure is here, and no power on earth can stop it.
You'll have to come out sometime. There's no other way.
Now, a different kind of alien is about to be born, and the entire universe is its victim. Outer space is expecting the unexpected. Witness the birth of Inseminoid. It is not a blessed event.
Greetings, everyone. This is Michael, and welcome back to B-Movie Mania. Now, if you'll recall, if you've watched these videos or you followed these videos, the past segments have dealt with films focusing on the legendary B-movie king himself, Roger Corman. And I haven't given up on films by Roger Corman. I've just taken a little break. And I decided to review some films that are not associated with Roger Corman, just to give me a little bit more variety. And today's film is no exception. It's the 1981 film entitled Inseminoid. Now, this is a movie that actually a YouTube user had suggested that I watch. And as a matter of fact, probably about four or five YouTube fans of the film has advised me to watch the movie. So one of them actually sent me the film, and I watched it tonight and decided, well, you know, I'm watching the movie, I may as well do a review of the film itself. Now, this is a film that definitely has received mixed reviews. It's a low-budget British science fiction film, and after watching it, I can understand exactly why the movie has received mixed reviews. Now, this is a movie that was directed by Norman J. Warren, and he's pretty much a 70s exploitation director. His probably most well-known film would be one called Satan's Slave, and I saw this years ago. Really have vague memories of it. I'd like to see it again. As a matter of fact, I actually ordered the film tonight. But Inseminoid is a film that has been wrongly compared to Ridley Scott's Alien film. A lot of people have compared it to that movie and pretty much labeled it a film that was made as a clone of the Alien classic. And after watching it, of course, that's definitely not true. I mean, you can compare films if you want, and you can find similarities in lots of different films because they're usually always there. But Inseminoid is definitely not a clone of Alien, and it's actually very different from Alien. Now, this is a really ultra low budget film, guys. As a matter of fact, it's probably a $1 million production budget here. And despite that, it has remarkably a really huge cast of actors. We have 12 actors in this film, and that's just the cast on the planet, the scientists. But at the end of the film, you also have like four military guys coming in on a spaceship to check on this team as well. So that's a pretty large cast for such a low budget film. And It's a really ultra low budget film, but I'll get into that a little bit later. But as far as the story goes, guys, it's fairly simple. You have a group of kind of scientific archaeologists on one of Jupiter's moons called Zeno. And they're exploring these ruins inside a cavern. They found these ancient writings and then these strange crystals that seem to be pulsating with some kind of life essence. Well, while two guys are down there in the caverns exploring, they are victims of an explosion caused by the crystals. One dies and the other is injured and taken to the infirmary. Well, a little bit later he wakes up and he's in this trance and he's trying to get back to the cavern and he's not listening to anybody. You know, they're saying, hey, snap out of it. You don't need to go down there and all this stuff. But he forces his way down into the caverns and he starts digging. And he frees this creature. And later on in the film, after he's been contained and actually killed, two other people go down to the cavern to collect some of these crystals. And of course, we have a male and a female. And the male is brutally killed by the creature while the female is brutally raped by the creature. Well, yeah, I mean, you know, it's not really, on screen, it's not really anything gory or just terrible like, you know, some of the other films. We have a lady strapped to a table. We see the creature, and you kind of see a side shot of her thighs, and you see this long glass tube kind of going between her thighs, and you see these lumpy green meatballs, like two of them slide down the tube. And I'm not for sure if that's the creature's penis, or if it's just the creature using this kind of tube to insert the sperm in her, or embryos, or whatever. It never really tells. But they find her later on, and they discover that she's 2 months pregnant. So basically, after that, the film kind of just goes through these cycles where you have this lady who's pregnant and losing her mind and being controlled, trying to defend her pregnancy. She wants to have these kids, and more or less, she's willing to kill the entire complement of scientists to protect these embryos. And she's also feeding on the people that she kills by sucking their blood. Sounds like a strange combination, don't it? But yeah, she kills her fellow scientists, and one by one, they're just, you know, when you see this cast of 12 people, you're watching the movie and you're sitting there thinking, oh yeah, that's a lot of people. We're going to see a lot of deaths here. And, you know, I'll leave it up to you guys to discover, you know, who lives, who dies. But, you know, there are deaths in the film. It is a horror film. Now, the one thing that I did notice, all the cast to me basically are unrecognizable. I know that a few of them have played in other films and maybe some television. But I did recognize the main star. Now, this is a lady that got impregnated and commences to killing her fellow scientist, but I thought, she looks familiar. She looks familiar. And then it occurred to me, the television show Space 1999, which I haven't seen in years, she played one of the characters there, and her name is Judy Geeson. And some of you may remember her, but most of you probably will not. But without giving away too much, guys, you know, she goes on this rampage, starts killing her fellow crew members, and that's basically what the film revolves around, her protecting these embryos. And then, of course, we do see the birth at the almost the end of the film. And I'll let you guys, you know, if you want to watch the film, figure out for yourself what happens. And you know what? One YouTube user suggested that, you know, I really like the fact that you don't put spoilers in the reviews, because a lot of people haven't seen the films. But he said, why don't you think about posting spoilers and then telling what happens? Because some of the films, I want to hear what happens at the end. Well, this is a spoiler alert, guys. Now, you're free to turn off the video or fast forward it a little bit past this, but I'm going to tell you what happens. First time, I'm going to tell you what happens at the end of the film. So cut it off now. Anyway, guys, at the end of the film, she has the two embryos, these two aliens, and immediately afterwards, one of the characters finds her laying next to the embryos. He rubs her head because he kind of has a feelings for her. She wakes up, tries to kill him. He ends up strangling her and finally killing her, despite the fact that she has superhuman strength now. This force that is controlling her has really given her strength. She's stronger than everybody else on the base, but he ends up strangling her. And the two aliens, we have this rescue team coming in to see what happened to everyone on the base. And they get there, and they don't discover anything except dead bodies laying everywhere, but they kind of pan into the ship, and you see the two little baby aliens in a trunk. They're like, this trunk lid raises up, and you see the aliens, and that's how it ends. But, spoilers, over with. I guess that's enough. If you didn't listen, now don't listen. But anyway, back to the film itself. Now, you know, this is a film that's gained a pretty huge cult following. One of the people that suggested I watch it said, oh, it's not really a great movie, but you might enjoy it if you like some of the Roger Corman stuff. And it plays very much like a Roger Corman film. It's nothing like Ridley Scott's blockbuster movie Alien. Nothing like it. So I don't understand the comparisons that people make. It may have been inspired by it, but it's definitely nothing like it. It's a low-budget film, and I'm kind of in the middle. I'm kind of 50-50 on this movie. I kind of like some aspects of it, which mostly is the cinematography, the camera work, because on a budget, shoestring budget that it has, they did a really great job of filming it and making the movie look good. God, the sets. I mean, this is a film that kind of even puts Roger Corman's production values to shame, because this film is just painfully low budget. There's a scene where one of the characters, the crazy girl, is pulling one of the other characters that she just killed by the hair, and you can see the little dolly that she's the character's laying on as she's pulling her. You can actually see it on camera. And there's a lot of little flubs like that. There's one scene where the doctor is trying to give the crazy woman a shot to put her to sleep, and you can clearly see the lid of the hypodermic needle covering the needle. So, I mean, you know, he's pushing it towards her neck, and it's like, dude, it's covered up. So, you know, you have a lot of sequences like that, guys. So, guys, in a nutshell, the movie is entertaining, but it really has a very strange screenplay. Some of the things that are written for the film is just really strange. I mean, the things that I mentioned beforehand, you know, about the odd things that the characters do, that the screenplay does, there's just many of them that are not related to the fact that the film is low budget. I mean, after the girl gets pregnant and goes on this killing spree, it's said that she has, not super strength, but she's really, really strong. Stronger than all the other people there. But she goes on a killing spree, and the screenplay really gets stupid. I mean, like for instance, after she's killed like two or three people, three of the characters find her laying behind this control panel, and she's just in this fetal position and just like, oh, all in pain. And there's a guy there and two women. And the guy sends the woman, he motions for the woman to go down there and touch her, try to help her. And I'm thinking, you wuss, why are you sending the woman? So of course she goes down there, starts rubbing her hair, and then the lady turns on her, kills her, and I'm thinking, she's already killed three people, why are you people doing this? You know, just bend down there and give the girl a shot, knock her out. And it continues throughout the whole film. I mean, you have this one girl, and you know, you have all these other people that are alive, that even after she's killed three or four people, you still have a pretty strong cast of people here that could overpower her. And they keep doing weird things throughout the entire movie. Everybody is so scared of this woman. But at the same time, nobody locks one door. They have these monitors everywhere. They watch where she is half the time. And nobody locks a door. She just has free rein to walk in and out of the place, wherever she pleases. I mean, everywhere. There is not a lock in this entire film. They lock no doors. And that's simple basic stuff there I would have done. I would have locked the freaking doors and locked her out. And, you know, I'm thinking when all this is going on, do we have any weapons? Are there any weapons here? Is there anything we can arm the people with that are so afraid and terrified? And nobody thinks to arm anybody. I mean, nobody steps up and says, hey, okay, here's a crowbar, here's a steel pipe. And they even have guns. What kind of guns were those? Kind of like harpoon guns. I'm thinking, why the hell do we have harpoon guns? There are no laser guns or anything like that. No machine guns. But they do have harpoon guns that shoot these big steel spikes. And nobody thinks to use this thing. I mean, they used it earlier in the film when the one guy went nuts. But they never use it again against this crazy-ass woman. And I mean, she's crazy. She has this shrieking scream that if you could either be terrified by it or you can laugh or be annoyed by it, but nobody defends themselves. I mean, and when they do defend themselves, it's piss poor. I mean, yeah, the woman's a little bit stronger, but you know, you have three or four able-bodied men here. Take your asses down there where you see her on the camera and kick this bitch's ass. I mean, I never really saw her as an adequate threat. I think that she could have easily been dealt with in the film. Of course, you wouldn't have much of a story there if they had just went down there and kicked her ass. But the story isn't written very intelligently because, I mean, every man in this story is a freaking wuss. I mean, every man, whenever the woman comes across a man, somehow the man loses consciousness. Either she knocks him down and he loses consciousness, and I shit you not, there's one scene where she bites a guy on the leg and he loses consciousness. I mean, the men, I don't know, maybe it's a future thing. The men in this future are wussies. I mean, and it kind of underscores what happens at the end of the film that I told you how she is finally dealt with. One guy who is injured is able to stop her. But at the same time, all these other men with no injuries can't do shit. So, while I thought the film was entertaining, it's not a very smartly written film. And if anything, it probably insults her intelligence because, you know, just the screenplay itself is just hilarious to watch these people who just cannot deal with this situation at all. I mean, one character wisely enough says, let's just kill her. Let's kill her. And people, after she's killed several people, they're saying, no, we can't kill her. But I was entertained by the film. It's a good time waster. But overall, it's just a silly movie that has gained a cult following. Here's my DVD, actually, guys. Pretty nice looking DVD. If I can get the glare off of it. But yeah, there we go. It's a pretty nice looking DVD. Filmed very well. I like the way the movie was filmed. And it's not a terrible movie. It's just not a very smartly written film. And I mean, you know, to have a cast of 11 characters not able to deal with one woman who is a little bit stronger than they are, to me, is just plain silly. Here's the DVD. They should have been able to stop her, in my opinion. But the way the film goes, it's just silly that all these people can't stop this one character. And the silliness that happens on screen, like, and you know, I'm not even for sure why she did this, but the crazy lady gets hold of some magnetic grenades. You just stick the grenades to metal, and then you have this little ignition pad that you push to ignite them. So she sticks like four to a door leading in. Now, when the door explodes, it explodes the opposite way. Instead of pushing the door forward where the bombs are, they explode backwards. And you think this is a big metal door from the way it looks, but when it explodes, you can see where it's actually constructed out of wood. And the sets are pretty, pretty sad, guys. I mean, you have sets here that are just, wow. They looked really, really pathetic. And the fact that half the time, all you see is a black sound stage with props sitting around this stage where you can't see deeply into what's behind all this stuff. So it makes Roger Corman's film look like they were multi-million dollar budgets. But at the end of the day, guys, it's a charming, kind of quaint movie with some decent action, some decent gore. But it's just a silly movie. A lot of it just don't make sense. I mean, you have one scene where a girl, and you know, you can't breathe outside of the base. So, in the cavern. So, you have one girl that traps her leg in this little bent-up piece of metal. Her leg goes in and she can't get out. And she's all panicking. And they contact her and they say, hey, she says, I'm losing power to my suit. More or less, I'm not going to be able to breathe. I'm going to lose my life support. So, they're trying to talk her into repairing the suit. And they say, all you need to do is connect two wires. And she can't even do that. Oh, I can't do it. I can't do it. And she can't connect the wires, so what does she do instead? She chops her damn foot off and still dies. So I'm thinking, you know, if I'm about to run out of air, I bet you damn well I'm going to connect those two wires together. So you just have a lot of silliness that you got to wonder when people are making movies, do they not see this stuff? Do they not? It's their own written, they're reading this stuff. So I don't know, guys. A time waster, definitely a decent time waster, kind of a charming film, pretty nice cinematography. I like the way it was filmed, but you know, it's a movie that's just, if you were really in the situation that these people were in, you would not do the things that they do, because in all actuality, I believe that these people should have been well able to control or kill this woman. And the creature that impregnates her, it comes out, kills one guy, impregnates her, and you never see it again. It just vanishes. I guess we can assume that it went back into the cavern, which conveniently all the rocks collapse over the entrance to the cavern so they can't get in anymore. So I assume the creature was in there. But you have no explanation given what happened to the creature. It just came out, screwed with the woman, and I guess, oh, after years of no sex, it felt good. I'm going back to bed. So I don't know if it had a cigarette in the cavern and then blew the cave, but you never see it again. So like I said, guys, mostly just to me a silly movie. I like it from a B movie standpoint, but even B movies usually are written just a little bit better, where you know just a little bit of the action makes a little bit of sense. But this one, it's just a hoot. It's just hilarious, and half the time, it's kind of hilarity mixed with pain, just seeing some of the stuff going on in the film. But I'd recommend Inseminoid. I mean, I'm glad that I have it in my collection. it's a time waster. Also known as Horror Planet here in the U.S., but I definitely recommend you give it a shot if you're into B-movies. I like collecting B-movies, so it's one that I enjoyed. In a time-wasting kind of way. But anyway, guys, thanks for watching. Look forward to more obscure B-movie mania films coming up in the future. Take care. Tonight's film, Inseminoid. It's a time-waster. Yeah, at the very least.